Hey there, my name is Drew Brashler, and in this video, I'm going to be doing an overview of the PreSonus StudioLive 16.0.2 USB. Now, if you're brand new to my channel, I'm all about helping you feel more confident in your production gear no matter where you're starting from. Also, if you are looking to become a better audio engineer and get some different tips and tricks, I have a weekly newsletter over at audiotoolkit.co that's free. So head over there, sign up for my weekly newsletter, and you will get an easy-to-read audio tips and tricks article in your email every week. But let's go ahead and dive in on the PreSonus StudioLive mixer that I have here. Now, this mixer is a 16-channel mixer spread over 12 faders. So that means that we have 8 mono channels between 1 and 8. And then 9 through 16 are 4 channels, and it can either be a mono channel or a stereo channel. So we have these 4 channels right here can be stereo channels. So 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, or 15 and 16. If we don't have stereo inputs, we can run this as a 12-channel mono mixer. So meaning that we have 12 mono inputs. So I can have 12 XLRs, or I can have 8 XLRs and 4 stereo channels in my board. Now, over on the right-hand side, we have our aux 1 through 4. And so I have individual level control over all of these auxes here. Now, I can pair my aux 1 and 2 by simply selecting and then pressing the link button right here. We now have linked my aux 1 and 2 together to make this a stereo pair, meaning that if we had some stereo in-ears that we needed to set up, I would want to link my aux 1 and 2. Now, if I wanted to unlink them, I can just press the link button again, and then they are back to 4 mono auxes. Now, to adjust the level going to these auxes, we can actually go up into our fat channel area, which is the middle section of our board, and then we have these rotary encoders right here. And so we have our 16 channels here, and if I was wanting to adjust my channel 1 up into aux 1, I would simply press aux 1 right here, and then I would take the first rotary knob and turn it up. If I wanted to also put channel 3 in there, I can. Now, if I was wanting to put channel 2 into aux 2, I would simply select aux 2, go to my channel 2, and turn it up. And so we can see that there's my aux 1 and my aux 2. Now, in addition to my 4 auxes, I have my main fader right here, and then I also have an effects section, so my effects A and my effects B, which you will notice that we have the ability of adjusting our channels into our effects section by pressing effects A and turning up our rotary knob for the particular channel. Now, I have my effects A and my effects B, and this is the fader for the level that's going to my mains. And I can select between having it go to my mains, and I can even add it to my auxes if I want to. Now, when we have our effects button pressed right here, we can see what effects we have loaded on our StudioLive. And there's a bunch of different effects, which I'm going to be covering in a different video. Now, moving over to the channels, I want to talk about the channel processing. So I'm going to go ahead and select my channel 1, which we will see our selected channel here will define what channel I have selected. So we can go through and select all of our channels. If I go and select an aux, we will see that this says aux A1, A2, meaning aux 1 and aux 2. We have our main, and we can also go and select our effects A and our effects B. But let's go back to our channel 1. Now, on the bottom of this fat channel, we have the ability of panning. So I have the ability of panning this channel from my left to my right, or keeping it directly in the center like this. We then have our input adjustments, which is a polarity reverse for instance, if we had a microphone on a snare drum on the top and a snare drum microphone on the bottom, we'd want to flip the polarity of one of those microphones to keep those microphones in polarity with each other. We then have the ability of activating or deactivating our phantom power for providing phantom power to an active DI box or a condenser microphone. We then also have the ability of copying, loading, and saving our channel presets into the board, which I will cover in a different video. We will then move up into our actual channel processing of our board. Now, we have all of these different sections that are laid out on this board. We have our first thing, which is our high pass filter, which is a low cut. Now, a high pass filter and a low cut basically just rolls off or gets rid of the low end on a channel if you don't want it. Now, I have the ability of selecting between 24 hertz and 1.3 kilohertz on my low cut. And if I was wanting to activate this high pass filter, all I would have to do is press the on and then dial in the frequency that I want to. Now, this is going to be useful for every channel pretty much. So if you have a channel that does not need to go to a subwoofer, for instance, a vocal microphone, then what I would recommend is turning on our high pass filter and setting that to 100 or 130 hertz, and that would remove that channel from any low end portion of your main PA. Now the next thing over we have is our gate, and we can go ahead and activate this, and we can adjust our threshold of this gate. Now a gate is going to be an instance of an automatic mute, if you will. So once the volume of this channel reaches below this threshold point that we're setting here, the mixer will automatically attenuate that channel and mute it. And down here on our meters button, if we go and select gain reduction, this will show the amount of volume that it's being turned down by our mixer with our gate. So if I was to go turn off the gate, we would notice that that would go away. And if I pressed it on, then it would go ahead and activate that gate again. Now, once the volume of this channel goes above that gate threshold, then the gate would automatically release that gate and open up that channel. Now we can get out of the gain reduction meters by go ahead and pressing meters again, and that will get us back into our channel. I'm going to go ahead and turn off this gate and lower the threshold back down. Now the next button that we have is our digital out. Now the StudioLive 16.0.2 USB gives us a 16 in and a 16 out USB connection on the back of the board that we could go and multi-track record into our computer, or we can even take those audio tracks and put them back into our mixer to do, say, a virtual sound check. Now, our digital out button allows us to choose if we want to take it right off the preamp, which if this is off, that is coming right off the preamp with no processing, or if we wanted to include the fat channel processing for our recording, we can just go ahead and simply press that. Now this is a channel by channel setting, so if I go to my channel 2, we will notice that that is off. And if I go back to my channel 1, we will notice it is on. The next thing that we have is our compressor. Now, our compressor allows us to dial in the amount of dynamics that we have on a channel. So if we have a channel that has a lot of volume swing going up and down, we can turn on our compressor and we can set our threshold so that this compressor will start compressing a channel once the volume of that channel goes above this threshold point. We have the ability of setting our ratio between 1:1 all the way up to full limiting. And then we have our response knob, which is going to be our attack and release times. So we can set this to tight, which is going to be a fast attack, a fast release, or we can set this all the way up to smooth, which would be a slow attack and a slow release. Or if you set this right in the middle, then it's going to be a happy medium between the two. Additionally, with our compression, anytime that we are applying compression, we are turning down that volume of that channel. So we can go and add makeup gain to counteract the amount of gain reduction that we're doing. And again, we can go back over to our gain reduction and see the metering of how much we would need to add in our makeup gain. Now, the next thing that we have is a limit button. Now, this limit button allows us to limit our channel at 0 dB full scale, which is the top of the channel. And this is just going to add a little bit of limiting on each channel on a channel-by-channel basis. The next thing that we have is our EQ section. Now, there are three bands of EQ. We have a low, a mid, and a high. Now, on our low band, we can go ahead and turn it on, and then we have the ability of adjusting between 36 hertz and 465 hertz with very specific dB numbers here. We have the ability of boosting or cutting all the way up to 15 dB above or 15 dB below. We also have the ability of changing the low band between a bell-shaped curve and a shelf. EQ, which a shelf EQ is going to boost all of the frequencies below our frequency by the amount set on our gain. So for instance, if I put this at 6 dB, all of my frequencies below 130 hertz are going to be boosted by 6 dB. Now, if I didn't have this on shelf and I just had this on the bell-shaped curve, only the frequencies around 130 hertz are going to be boosted by 6 dB. Now, our mid band gives us the ability of adjusting between 260 hertz and 3.5 kilohertz, and again, boosting or cutting up to 15 dB. As well as the ability of changing the bell curve from a wide bandwidth to a narrow bandwidth. So if we wanted to have a narrow bandwidth, we can go ahead and press the high Q button. This is going to be helpful if we have a piece of feedback. For instance, if I had a piece of feedback happening at 1.4 kilohertz, I would want to go ahead and set this to high Q and then go ahead and just notch out the little bit of feedback that I'm having on this particular channel. If I was wanting to do tone shaping for actually affecting the tone of a channel, then I would want to go ahead and have high Q turned off, as this is going to give us the most tonality benefit to our EQ. We then have our high band, which gives us the ability of adjusting between 1.4 kHz and 18 kHz, again boosting or cutting up to 15 dB, either way, as well as a shelf. So this is a similar shelf to the low shelf, but the high shelf is going to boost all of the frequencies above our frequency point by the dB amount that we have set on our gain. So again, if I put this to 6 dB up and I turn on shelf, this is going to boost all the frequencies above 5 kHz by 6 dB. If I did not have shelf turned on and I had this on my bell-shaped curve, this would just be boosting all of the frequencies around 5 kHz by 6 dB. Now, going across the very top of the mixer, we have our input gain, or our preamp gain. So this is going to be our gain settings for all of our inputs on the back of the board. So if I have a microphone that I plug into input one here, and I go to my meters, I can go ahead and select my input meters, and then we can see my input as I'm adjusting my preamp gain. So we can see that I have the ability of having a clip light, which means that this channel is distorting. So I never want to have this clip light activating. Now, when we are setting our preamp gain, we want to have our input levels being right around the middle of this board. Now, a good example of that is where this C label is. This is going to be right in the middle of the board. Now, when I'm setting this preamp gain, I'm going to have the musician play the loudest that they would be during their set. So if it's the loudest portion of the chorus of an end of a song, I'll have them play that. That way, I am getting a good amount of signal coming into my mixer for when I'm setting this preamp gain. So for instance, check, 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 check. I'm going to lower this until I get this around right in the middle. So it's okay if the volume of this channel goes above every now and then, but the majority of this channel should be right in the middle, right about there. And so then if I went ahead and turned this up, we would go ahead and hear this in our mixer. Check, check, check. Now, additionally, with our meters, we can go ahead and press the output portion of our meters here, which then on the bottom of these little LED screens, we can see output meters. So we can see this is our aux 1 level, our aux 2, aux 3, aux 4, left, and our right. So as we're mixing here, if I was to turn this up a lot, we would see that gain go up, or if I was to turn this down, we would see that go away. Additionally, if I was going to adjust this channel up in my aux 1, I can, and then we can see that on my output meter, I am getting nice and loud on this aux 1, which is going to be a little bit too loud, but that's okay. Now we have our gain reduction meter, which is going to show us how our compressor and how our gate is applying attenuation to that channel, which I will be covering compression and gating on a different video. Now moving on into this next portion of our mixer, we have the ability of having our USB connection. Now like I was saying, this board is a 16 in, 16 out USB connection with your computer. So I could have Ableton or a DAW playing some backing tracks, and I could actually play that into my mixer to play along with. So if I was wanting to select between my analog and my USB input, I would go ahead and select this little USB symbol, and then I would simply press these buttons to select what channels I want to have coming in from my computer. So for instance, I have some tracks playing on my 9 through 16, and we can go to my inputs and we can see that those are playing right there. And so if I was to turn these channels up, we would hear that. And if I was wanting to turn those off from being on my USB to put them back to being the analog input, I would want to make sure that those lights are turned off. The next thing that we have is our solo. So if I go ahead and press solo, I can actually solo an individual channel up in my headphones. Now, if I have some headphones connected onto the front of this mixer, I would want to go ahead and have solo selected here, and then I have my volume level for my headphones, as well as my monitor out on the back of the board. There is a TRS output on the back of the board that allows me to connect my mixer to some near field monitors to be able to solo them in that. Now, if I was wanting to listen to my main mix in my headphones, I would also want to press main. Now, one thing that's actually kind of neat is that I can solo as well as listen to the mains at the same time. So this is going to be a summing amplifier here. So if I have solo and main selected, I'm going to be listening to both of them on my headphones, as well as I can press the USB button to be able to listen to my output 1 and 2 coming from my computer into my console. Now, this is going to be super helpful if you're using this mixer with a DAW for some recording. You can simply press this and you can listen to your main output coming from your DAW back into your console. Now, the next thing that we have down here is our mute button. Now, this is going to allow us to mute our channels. So we can see that I have my channel here and I have it turned up, and here if I'm to unmute my channel and mute my channel, so now we don't hear the doubling of my voice, and now we do hear the doubling of my voice. So our mute allows us to turn on and off individual channels as we please. Now, the other thing that we have down here is a link. Now, the link button allows me to link an odd and an even channel together. So for instance, I have my channel 1 selected here, I can link my channel 1 and 2. Now, one thing I do want to mention here is I cannot link my channel 2 and 3 together. I can only link an odd and an even channel together. So 1 and 2 can link, 3 and 4 can link, so on and so forth. Now, one thing to mention is if you do use the stereo inputs on the back of the board, you will need to link your channel with 9 and 10, which will then separate those out to be stereo. So for instance, if I go and listen in on my tracks here, I can go ahead and select these channels and I can press the link, which will change them into stereo. So we will hear my mix here is very centered. And now it is in a stereo spread. So just keep that in mind. If you are using the stereo portion of these channels, you will need to select that channel and you will need to press link. And the main difference that you'll see here is that it will go from being just a center pan to a left and a right, signifying that it's now set in stereo. Now, I hope this video was helpful for you today. If you do happen to have any questions about this video, or if you're hoping that I will make a specific video about the PreSonus Studio Live or any of the production mixers that are out there, please post those comments in the comment section down below, as I'm always reading through those comments to find videos that are going to be helpful for you. If you haven't already, make sure to go over to my website and check out drewbrashler.com, where I have a whole bunch of articles, tips, and tricks there. Otherwise, I hope you have a great day.